Hi guys, my name is Kashif Piracha. I am an internal medicine physician currently in clinical practice in the city of Houston in Texas, United States. And I'm gonna be doing a series of lectures that I'm planning to do to help the medical students understand the mechanics of internal medicine, because that's my specialty. That's where I'm going to begin. But what I want to tell you guys is that there is a way that you can approach any clinical case, whether it's on the exam or whether it's on the real life, and there is a way that you can analyze the data and come up with the right diagnosis or right treatment in a very efficient and productive manner. And that's really going to help you, because whenever you'll be evaluating a patient, there's going to be a lot of data. Some of that data is going to be relevant, some of it is not going to be relevant. Well, you need to be able to figure out exactly how you can dig down and pick out the important aspects and leave the aspects that are not important. This is absolutely important when you are taking a test, because the examiners are going to be giving you a lot of data, and a lot of that is not going to be relevant to the question that's being asked. And you have to stay focused, and you have to make sure you pick the right path, which will get you to the right answer. And that's what I'm going to try to do, is to try to talk about various internal medicine diseases and conditions in future lectures. But I wanted to start initially with a way that you can approach any clinical vignette with a single best answer platform. I just thought it would be a good idea to just first find a method where we can approach a clinical vignette question in the most appropriate way before I go on to different clinical conditions and try to give you an overview about how you can approach a question for different clinical conditions in the most efficient manner. So let's start. So I have called this system that I'm trying to develop as a peak learning system. And what exactly is this system? So this system is a learning system designed to train you to become the best clinician by providing you with the tools you require to evaluate patient data in the most effective manner, to accurately diagnose and efficiently treat your patients so they can have the best possible outcomes. Also, this system will teach you the best methodology you can apply to succeed on any exam with a clinical vignette question format with a single best answer. So how do you approach a clinical vignette efficiently and methodically? So there are many different ways people will tell you to do this. The way that always works for me is you quickly read the question very superficially and take a peek at answer choices to get an idea of what is being asked. When I took my USMLE step 2 examination, I wasted a lot of time when I was trying to read through the whole question first, and when I was done with the stem, I was very confident that I got the right diagnosis, but I didn't look at the answer choices. And then I realized that, you know, they're not even asking about the diagnosis. They're asking about something else. They're asking about related conditions, or they'll ask you about a physical exam finding, or they'll ask you about a treatment. So it's real important that at the beginning, if you look at the answer choices, so while you are reading the question, you have some idea exactly what they are asking. So that's why I said, do not make the mistake of spending all your time reading the stem of the question and coming up with an answer in your mind only to find out something different is being asked. Like you came up with the diagnosis, but the question is about the correct treatment. So if you use my system and methods, which I call the peak learning system, you are a peak learner. You're a peak learner. So how do you approach the stem of a clinical vignette? So the stem of the question is where all the money is. All data has been provided to you, and now it's up to you to pick the correct answer. There's going to be a lot of noise. And what I mean by that, noise is data that they have put in there to lead you astray. That you're going to chase that and you're going to go in a wrong direction, you get a wrong answer. That's a lot of noise. We don't like noise. We gotta clear out the noise. You have to ignore the unimportant and latch on to the important clues to find your way to the correct answer. So it all sounds very complicated, right? But it doesn't have to be if you are methodical. You have to have a method. Develop a strategy to find your way through. We'll talk about that on the next slide. So the way I want you to approach the clinical vignette as a peak learner is I want you to dissect the stem of the question into three different indicators. So they are right here. So the first indicator is this. Number one, they are your helpers. And we're gonna explain that all in the coming slides, what exactly is a helper. The second are your guiders. They guide you. I know guider is not a word, I made it up, but it sort of works well for my system. They guide you. And the third one are the clinchers. They clinch the diagnosis for you. You master them and you will be successful, and I guarantee you that. So look here. So first we're going to talk about the helper. What is the helper? So a helper is the demographic information, age, sex, and ethnicity. That's most commonly the three components of the demographic information that you're going to be provided with. Comorbid conditions and risk factors in the question stem. So why do I call it a helper? So I call it a helper because it only helps, because it can provide extra support to your answer, but a helper in itself is insufficient to get you to pick the right answer. That's why it's only a helper. So let me give you an example, a question on the next slide. We'll go through an example and we'll discuss another one. So this is an example question, okay? So I say a 70-year-old obese African-American man with a past medical history of hypertension, diabetes mellitus type 2, and hyperlipidemia, who has been smoking one pack per day for the last 40 years, presented to the emergency department with sudden onset of substernal chest pain while he was sipping his coffee sitting on his couch. Pain is pressure type, squeezing, and associated with diaphoresis, nausea, and feeling of doom. So what do you think? So I guarantee you that a lot of you are currently thinking that this is a pain for acute coronary syndrome, right? This guy is either having unstable angina or he's having a non-ST elevation MI or a ST elevation MI. I mean, there's everything there. But look here, what if I throw in that he had a viral upper respiratory tract infection a week ago? And I show you an ECG that has diffuse ST elevations across the precordium in many leads, consistent with acute pericarditis. So what will you do? Are you going to treat him with aspirin and heparin and clopidogrel, just like you would treat an acute coronary syndrome? Well, of course not. You don't treat acute pericarditis with antiplatelet and anticoagulant agents. It may cause bleeding into the pericardial sac, which is bad. I mean, real, real bad. And what does real, real bad mean on the test? Well, it means a wrong answer, and we wouldn't want that. We want the right answer. So let's reevaluate the question a little bit. See what's the methodology, okay? So let's start here. So the first thing I said is a 70-year-old. Okay, so you know that coronary artery disease is more common in men who are greater than 45 and women who are greater than 55, right? You already know that. So this is one thing that goes with somebody having a cardiac etiology chest pain, right? Well, the second thing I throw in is that he is obese too. You know, obesity is a very common cause of coronary artery disease. So he's obese. What about this? He's African American. So when we talk about ethnicities, we know that coronary artery disease is more common in African Americans. So now we have the age, we have the sex, it's coronary artery disease more common in men, we have obesity, and we have the fact that he's an African American. You already have four things that go with coronary artery disease or cardiac chest pain. Now I throw in some other things too. What about hypertension? He has hypertension. What about diabetes mellitus type 2? What about hyperlipidemia? I mean, these are like the rock solid indicators of cardiac etiology chest pain. So now you have seven of them. He's been smoking one pack per day for the last 40 years. What do you make of that? Like, that's one of the big risk factors for coronary artery disease, smoking. Now that's number eight. Now he's having retrosternal chest pain, which is very common for coronary disease. But you gotta keep in mind the next thing that I'm gonna talk about, which is he had the pain while he was sipping his coffee sitting on his couch. Now that could be cardiac etiology chest pain, but it would go more with an acute coronary syndrome and not with chronic stable angina. And what's the differentiation? We're going to talk about that in a future lecture. But also look at this. Pain is pressure type, squeezing, and associated with diaphoresis, nausea, and feeling of doom. So the reason I make it so clear cut is that all of these things are like so typical of pain from cardiac etiology, okay? But here's the point. All of these clues that I just gave you are mere helpers, nothing else. If the ECG they show you has acute coronary syndrome and you select that answer and it is correct, then these helper clues were just corroborating your diagnosis. But after giving you all this data, if I say he had a viral upper respiratory infection a week ago and I show you an ECG consistent with acute pericarditis, then you know what? You know, you might as well just throw these helpers out of the window, because you cannot pick the right answer just based on them. The thing is, you know, being 70 year old and having hypertension, diabetes, obesity, hyperlipidemia, they're all risk factors for coronary artery disease and acute coronary syndrome, but somebody who's having acute pericarditis can have all these things too. I mean, these things just don't guarantee that this is acute coronary syndrome. So what is the moral of the story? The moral of the story is that every clinical vignette starts with the helper. They are gonna give it to you for every single question. You read them. Read them carefully and make a mental note. But move forward with the knowledge that further information may either corroborate, and that's the key word, corroborate your helpers or contradict your helpers. If the information down the line is corroborating your helpers in your decision-making progress, you can stick with them. In the end, you can say, yeah, you know what? He had all these risk factors. The EKG showed ST elevation MI. He has ST elevation MI, and that's nice and good. But if the information down the line contradicts your helpers, then they're of no use, because and that's where the word helper comes in. They were mere helpers. They were not designed to always get you to the right diagnosis. You can have them and use them, but be wary. You cannot make the final decision based upon your helpers. That's the big point. So anyways, I don't want to make this first lecture really long. I just want to make it real short so I can get some feedback from you guys. Now, I have another example that I wanted to share with you. Suppose we have the same patient, a 70-year-old guy with hypertension, diabetes, hyperlipidemia, smoker, all that kind of stuff. And you're looking at all the helpers in the question and you're feeling pretty good. It's chest pain from coronary etiology. But what if I tell you that he had 104 degree fever, he's having productive cough, he's having pleuritic chest pain, he's having chills, and show you an x-ray that has an infiltrate. Now, what are you going to do? Again, the guy may most likely is having a pneumonia, right? I mean, just because he's got all these risk factors doesn't mean he can only have cardiac etiology chest pain. It can mean a lot of other diseases too. So again, just use the helpers, but just make sure that you don't make your final decision just based on the helpers. There's a lot more that you need to consider. So finally, I just want to wrap it up. I wanted to introduce myself to you, and I want to try to give you this new way of solving clinical vignette questions, where you're going to focus on three things: helper, guider, and clincher. If you use my methods and you use these strategies, you're going to get to the answer quickly, which is going to save you a lot of time on the test because they only give you a minute or two, and you need to be methodical, and you're going to score good on the test. And remember, the battle is half won in the mind and the other half on the battlefield. Being mentally prepared is the absolute key for success. You need to have a strategy going into the exam, how you're going to solve the question. You can't just get to the exam and devise the strategy while you are taking the test. That's not good. That's a recipe for disaster. In the next presentation, I'm going to talk about the other two indicators, guiders and clinchers. And we're going to spend some time on that. And depending upon what kind of feedback I get from you guys, we can always modify these lectures and look at the different aspects. So I thank you for your time, and please give me your feedback. I took my exam, USMLE Step 2, many, many years ago, but I remember it was stressful. I was nervous. It was hard. And I got through, and I just want to tell you guys, you're going to get through too. You just have to stay focused, develop a strategy, and you're going to do just fine. Thank you for your time. I'll see you guys and gals soon. And thank you for your attention.